morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to see so many ladies and a few brave men here who've chosen to be part of this wonderful morning. I have about 8 minutes to speak. I'm actually hoping to keep it a little shorter than that because I don't want to be one of those people inflicting on aggrieved listeners the drone monotonous sound of a person who perhaps may love their voice. I want to use this opportunity today to talk about three things that are very important to me. Things that I have actually spoken about on multiple platforms at multiple occasions. And I never feel the need to not reiterate them ever. So I'm saying something I have said 100 times before, and I will always use every platform to talk about things that mean something to me. The first thing I want to talk about is the accident of birth. Now, the accident of birth is something that governs everything that happens in our life. The fact that we are sitting here in this room and not somewhere else is not because we live in a society that's equal, where there's equal opportunity. It's simply because we were born into a home that gave us the opportunity that ideally should be given to everyone. Let me put this in context. A couple of years ago, I was at my village in Punjab, where I routinely go and, you know, I used to get some stuff done in my informal capacity. And I was sitting with the district magistrate trying to request him to direct some Narega funds, which the district magistrate in every district controls, for some project that we wanted done in our area. And over a cup of tea, he said, you know, I just thought I'd mention to you that our area has the lowest sex ratio in the country. So this is as per the previous census. I come from a district called Fatehgarh Sahib. It's in Punjab. And in fact, I was meeting the DC of Fatehgarh Sahib to get this particular project done. And I was actually astounded. I had gone to get something like a waterway drainage system which had been encroached upon, cleaned up using Narega funds and Narega labor, because it's always difficult to get these things done. And I walked away shocked, because that thing just paled in comparison to the knowledge that my district in Punjab had the lowest sex ratio in the country. And here I was living the 21st century emancipated woman's dream, doing everything I wanted to do, living every dream that I've ever dreamt of. And the impact that knowledge had on me was devastating. And I realized that I had to do something about it. Whether I would actually be able to impact the final outcome wasn't something that I had even thought about. And that's why I set up this this NGO called the Colonel Shamsher Singh Foundation, named after my grandfather. And the idea was to work on gender issues. Now, gender issues sounds like a really broad term, but our goal was simply to get conversation started through a public-private partnership format. So what that essentially means is, when you set up an NGO, you don't necessarily have the funds to do everything you want to do. But the good thing is, the government machinery has a robust blueprint for everything. From urban sanitation to rural 100% literacy, there is a blueprint for everything. What it usually lacks is enthusiasm. And I think that's where the non-governmental sector and volunteering can really, really help. So we worked on a lot of projects with the government projects at a district level. And most of our work concentrated on having conversations with groups of women like this in villages. Because if baby girls weren't being allowed to be born, then there was a conscious decision and an attempt being made by families to skew the kind of a child that they would have. And one interesting thing that came out during this engagement process, and it still comes out, is that we conducted a signature campaign in our area, which simply said in Punjabi that I am against female feticide. We got about 25,000 signatures supporting the campaign. And these things are usually activators to get your mind thinking, so you go back and you talk about it. These are small tools that all of us are familiar with. What's interesting is that over 3,000 women held the pen and did not sign. They held the pen and said, no, I'm not supporting this. They say it's very easy for you to talk about female emancipation when you live in cities like this, but think about it from the perspective that I have to pay dowry for my daughter when she gets married. I have to take care of everything that needs to be done. Why should I inflict on her a life that I've been forced to lead? So that was an interesting context. So what we did as far as our gender work is we conducted lots and lots, and we do conduct lots of what today are known as town halls, but essentially groups of 25, 30, 40 women that are given the opportunity to interact with an emancipated woman. She doesn't come and preach. She doesn't come and tell them what they should do. She simply comes and has a conversation with them, whether she's a police officer, a Supreme Court lawyer, a media person, or a businesswoman. So I set up these forums for them to have informal conversations with women so that we can seed in them the thought that A, boys and girls are equal, B, that you can have a daughter support the family just like a son does. The second thing I want to talk about is questioning everything. Everything. Because when you question everything is when you realize that there are so many things that you accept without even realizing that those things were actually a choice for you. When I was young, I was a bit of a rebel. And I'm actually happy I was a rebel because it allowed me to question the status quo of everything. Two particular incidents come to mind, actually. One is when I was in college. I went to college in this really glamorous town called Patiala, in a very glamorous college called Government College for Girls. And I was filling up my forms to appear to get the admission process all sorted, when that evening, a colleague of my father's asked me, "So, what are you going to be studying? Arts?" And I was astounded that he would assume that I was a girl and I should study arts. And actually, to be honest, I had planned to study arts because I had many other plans besides college. So I thought, I could do some kind of a humanities subject and I could continue all my other agendas on the side. But I was so stung by the assumption of this colleague of my father's that I said, no, I'm actually studying mathematics. And I mean, I was obviously reasonably good in mathematics. You have to be able to get the option in college. So I went and filled up maths. And that actually was a catalyst for me because I realized that those of us who studied maths in school and then in college, you realize up until school, mathematics is fun, it's applied, it's solution-based. But the moment you go into college, it's about proving theorems. And it's like remembering pages, pages, pages worth of proofs that don't essentially make any sense. Because Descartes or somebody, or Fibonacci, figured out something 200 years ago and now we just have to prove it again and again. And I realized that I want to do so much more in my life, and it was because of that that aspect in college of me having to choose maths that my brain began working in directions where I actually was interested. The second thing was my own father that I, the question that I asked my father. There were two hand-me-down motorcycles in my house, one motorcycle and one conventional two-wheeler. Basically, there were two hand-me-down two-wheelers from my cousins available for me to make the trek to college every day. And the assumption was I'll take the gearless one because scooties are what girls should ride. And I said, but it's eventually about balance. So if you can balance, you can surely change gears. And I said, I'm just going to take the Hero Honda when there was another Kinetic Honda available. I mean, this I'm talking 20 years ago. So, and my dad also probably, again, very liberal man, very forward-thinking, but so deeply conditioned by patriarchy without realizing it. I mean, so much of our conditioning is so deep that our conscious mind isn't able to spot it. So I started riding a motorcycle to college, much to everybody's surprise. And I realized then that every choice we make is actually preconditioned. It's not really a choice. I mean, it's assumed that we should marry at a certain age, we should choose certain subjects, we should marry a certain kind of man. And all these choices benefit just one thing: the perpetuation of patriarchy. Every choice that is predetermined is designed to perpetuate patriarchy. And the irony of it is patriarchy is detrimental not just to women, but to men. For instance, why should it be assumed that only the man should be the main breadwinner in the family? Why should he take the burden? Ki isne to naukri karni hi hai, she can do what she feels like. Why is it that the entire onus of providing for the whole family is placed on the man's shoulders? And why is it that the woman chooses to have her career as fun, So all of us equal feminist women must be aware that we are also benefiting to some extent from such patriarchal choices that have put unfair burdens on our men. I think getting rid of patriarchy and creating a more equal environment where every gender can play its role to its fullest is equally important for men as women, because men are also trapped in gender traps. And I think in an equal society, we must rid everybody of the gender traps they live in. Lastly, I want to talk about the power of showing up. The difference between achieving something and planning it, dreaming about it, wanting it, is actually just showing up. A lot of people have a lot of grand plans in their life, or for their day, or for their week. But the ones who achieve those plans are not extraordinary people, they're just people who show up. So whether it's something as simple as building exercise into your daily schedule, everybody wants to exercise, everybody wants to be fit. How many show up to work out? So, I mean, I'm reducing it to something so basal, something so basic that we all strive for. We all want to be the fittest, best version of ourselves. But how many of us show up? Of course, you can choose this, you can choose to take this to much loftier heights, and I'm running out of time, so I'm going to quickly summarize this. But by simply deciding that you are going to do something, you're actually showing up. I want to use three examples to point out how showing up changed the course of my life. One was, I was in college, like I said, in glamorous Patiala at the glamorous government college for girls. And there was a pageant being held, the Miss Patiala pageant. So I was like, a lot of girls talked about entering it. And I was like, you know, what the hell, I'm just going to enter it. I came like fifth. But it showed me that if you show up, you can at least get the ball rolling. Then I read about the Miss India pageant in a magazine, and a lot of my friends wanted to enter that pageant. I ended up sending my pictures and followed through. So I again showed up, and that pretty much changed the course of my life. A couple of years ago, I felt very, I mean, like all of us in this room, I felt very strongly about what was happening around us. And I was what most people would call an armchair activist, commenting on everything and had an opinion on everything. And then there came a time when I realized that, you know, here's an opportunity for me to do something about the way things are around me. You may not agree with my views politically, but I felt that here is an opportunity for me to actually put my money and my energy and my life where my mouth is. And that's why I fought my first election, because I showed up. For everybody else who sits in the house and complains about the way things are and brings down other people who are actually doing something, keep that in mind. That those who are actually out there, whether they are part of the political system as those who stand for elections or those who are in some way or the other supporting the system, are showing up. We're just sitting at home. And counting, turning up to vote is not showing up. Well, of course, it's an important part of electoral democracy. But think about the fact that the reason we have the kind of a leadership that we do is because those people have chosen to show up and do something about it, whereas we just complain. I don't mean disrespect to those of us who don't partake in electoral process beyond voting, but it's worth thinking about that we as a society are happy to complain, but we're not happy to show up and get things changed. We don't want to get our hands dirty, and you know, we can complain about how dirty the Versova beach is, but it takes an observer to go out and actually clean the beach, because he shows up and does it, and then in doing so inspires so many of us. The last thing I want to talk about in terms of showing up is I had this dream that I wanted to fly planes. And not to fly, not commercially, not for a living, but just to sort of fly and enjoy myself for thrill. And you know, as someone who pretty much did everything that I wanted to do and still do, my husband said to me, "So why are you not doing it?" And of course, it did mean diving back into the books, taking time out of my schedule, doing this, spending a year of my life studying a lot. Just for context, pass mark for flying exams is 70%. So it's not your 35% that you can just write an exam and come back home and say, "Hey, I got a license." Because a lot of, and you know, I met so many people after that across, I mean, somebody, you know, made me a bit of a temporary poster girl of somebody who does everything she wants. And so many girls came up to me and said, "We want to do this too." And I understand it's an expensive hobby. When I say so many girls I met, wanted to pursue this too, were the kinds who could afford this hobby but would prefer to buy a Chanel bag. So, and that's pretty much the cost of what it takes to get a flying license. My simple point here is a lot of us have dreams. A lot of us have a desire to do something. But eventually, the outcome of things is decided by those who show up. And if we don't show up, we can't expect the outcome to be the way we'd like. I rest my case. Thank you once again.